Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So today we will discuss poems of William Blake and poems from seventh block. I mean poems of Shelley and Keats. Okay. One second. So here onwards we are going to learn three-dimensional poems. Okay. One second. Are you able to see the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So actually, William Blake is from sixth block. I told you that we will discuss today. Well, William Blake is a pre-romantic poet. Okay. He's a pre-romantic poet, 1757 to 1827. Well, why he is known as a pre-romantic poet? Because he was a revolutionary. He was a mystical poet. A visionary poet. That made him a pre-romantic poet. His ideals are very much close to that of romantic poets. And his poetry tradition is a reaction against the 18th century writers. Okay. Yeah. So he was a painter, poet, and engraver. But he was not that famous during his lifetime. Anyway, let me tell you, see, almost all his poems have been engraved. He himself engraved all his poems. I told you, because of his mystical tone, his revolutionary ideas, he was considered as a madman by people during his time. Now, let me tell you, he was an anarchist. He was a believer, but different from that of the ordinary ones. His very ideology, his belief, etc., are very hostile to Church of England, or entirely different from the belief of normal people. So, for that reason, he was believed as a. I mean, he was considered anarchist. Then. He was influenced like Coleridge, and Wordsworth. He was also influenced by French Revolution. Now, yes. Now let me tell you, he was a forerunner of the free love movement. He was against the tradition of marriage or all those type of institutionalized things, religion. All those things that institutionalized, human living conditions, such as in the terms of religion, love, etc. He revolted against such traditions. Okay. Yeah. So according to Blake, human beings and God, they are not two different entities, but we are same. So, if you want to worship God, be good to our fellow beings. Okay. Now, just like the one we have in the Indian tradition, Tattvamasi. Okay. Now, anyway, his mythologies is based on Bible, Greek, and Norse mythology. I mean, one from Germany. Okay. So anyway, his philosophies are a bit complex. Okay. Anyway, ordinary people find too difficult to understand him because he was a visionary poet. I told you, he's a man of great vision. So according to William Blake, vision is a secret of life. From a very young, I mean, when he was a boy, from that age onwards, he used to, he perceived vision. normally people have the thinking capacity. We imagines, I mean, we imagine things, isn't it? But whatever thing he imagined, he had the ability to reconstruct it. I told you the poems he has written, he has engraved it. Once again. Now, well, he was also against those, theories of Isaac Newton and Charles Darwin, and the popular theories of 18th century, that is theory of enlightenment and empiricism, rationalism. Okay, so once again, I'm emphasizing the point that he was against all sort of institutionalized or theoretical concepts, like enlightenment, rationalism, empiricism, etc., etc. Okay. Now, he believed only in visions, the divine vision that one perceives from God or nature. Okay. It is the experience. It is the harsh experience that teaches man about the higher knowledge. Okay. Now, well, I told you he is considered as the forerunner of free love movement. Forerunner of 19th century free love movement. And why? Because he was against all sort of restrictions upon, free love. That is homosexuality, prostitution, adultery, birth control. He was against restriction upon all these things. And he was also against institutionalizing love, that is in the terms of marriage. Okay. He says that marriage is a death of true love. Okay, one second. Now, so we have discussed this term, that why he has been considered as a forerunner to the romantic movement. This person is considered as a forerunner to the romantic movement because most of his ideals, philosophy, parallels with that of the romantic poet, especially to that of Shelley and other second generation poets. Okay. So he doesn't have an ideal, he doesn't have any kind of ideal philosophy or religion or any kind of religious worship like that of other poet. No. So, and he believes that any kind of restriction, actually, any kind of restriction means a restriction in the terms of religion, love, philosophy, science, etc., actually human beings, put human beings in chain. Okay. Let it be science, religion, or philosophy. He considered all those things as a chain, a fetter. That is why he was against this thing. And he was led by his own visions. Well, let me tell you, his poetry, painting, and etc. are didactic in nature. They carried some message. So he wanted human beings to free themselves from the conventions and traditions. And he wanted them, human beings, to depend upon their own institution to realize their own strength and potential. Okay. Yeah. So in this way, he was a revolutionary. He was revolutionary in his theme, style, diction, technique, and philosophy. Now, have you understood why this person is considered as a pre-romantic poet? Because 18th century poet, they were, they had some moral codes. They followed strict rules and, restrictions. They idealized those Latin writers, and some of them were Tories and some of them were Whigs. They had their own religion, politics, etc. I mean, their poetry, everything is based on, writings were mostly based on, discussion that have been held in the coffee houses. Okay, but Blake, Blake was entirely against the traditions of the 18th century. Okay. Because he gave importance to one's imagination, especially age after 18th century, from 19th century onwards, it's the age of science and reason, isn't it? Yeah, it's the age of science and reason. In that age only, he gave importance to institution and importance to one's imagination. Okay. One second. So anyway, his famous collections are Songs of Innocence and Songs of Experience. In this work, he sees the world through the eyes of a child. So according to the author, in general, in childhood is the most happiest period in one's life, isn't it? So it is the time where one possess innocence, happiness, self-enjoyment, and a unity, a union with nature, just as in Wordsworth's poem, isn't it? In last class, we have discussed the poetry, poem Prelude by William Wordsworth, where he discussed that when he was a child, he had a divine union with nature. Similarly, it's childhood is the happiest period or happiest phase in one's life. Original state of, so he says that, author says that it is the original state of happiness, self-enjoyment, and where one can unite with nature. Because where human beings, when they grow old, they became they lose their innocence. Due to their circumstance, they tend to be cruel with their fellow beings. Yeah. So in his poem, he expresses a deep indignation towards this kind of hypocrisy, cruelty in the adult world. And you can also see a deep sympathy for poor and the suffering and underprivileged in the society. Okay, now let me tell you, he was also, again, I told you he was a revolutionary. He was a rebel. He was against all those anti-social practices that prevailed in the 19th century society. 19th or 18th, second half of the 18th century. Okay. Now, in this block, you can study Tiger, Lamp, Chimney Sweeper, London, etc. Some of his few famous poems. Okay, so, and the spelling, Tiger. Tiger spelling is entirely different, isn't it? From that of the one we use today. So that it should shows his uniqueness. Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forest of night. What immortal hands or eyes could frame thy fearful symmetry? See, let me tell you, Tiger, he has written two poems. One is Tiger and one is Lamb. Lamb is the poem that he has written first. Later only he has written Tiger. So in Lamb and Tiger, he shows two type of, two aspects of God. The furious aspect and the innocent side. So, see, both Tiger and Lamb are created by God. So, in the poem Lamb, we can see that he equates the very quality of Lamb with that of the God. Here in Tiger, he equates the ferocious quality and the with that of God. And apart from that, you can see the other side is that he equates human being with that of God, because it is God who had created human beings. Since he had created human beings, all his creations have his quality. I mean, all his creation share his quality. So, what? Tiger, lamb, or whatever thing on earth have all his same features. So, in that case, human beings and man are not two different entities, but they are same. Okay. So, tiger also presents two aspects of human being or human nature. Okay. And one more thing. Lamb can be seen as the early phase of a human being. I mean, childhood state of human being. And tiger is the adult state. Okay. Now, let's see. So, when you write the poem, if you're getting an essay question from William Blake session, you may please try to incorporate whatever points I have conveyed now. We have to convey that he was a poet who was against all those kind of restrictions of the 18th century, and he was entirely against this the restrictive society of during his period, and he was against all those type of institutionalized ideals. Then he was a supporter of free love. Then he was a visionary poet, he was against science, reason, religion. He was an absolute anarchist. Okay, and he equated he believed in a higher type of philosophy, something that is beyond religion. I told you, where he equates man and God. According to William Blake, man, human being and God, they are not two different things, but they are same. Okay, now let's see. Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forest of the night, what immortal hands or eye could frame thy fearful symmetry? So in this poem, he's asking, who created tiger? Because tiger is such a ferocious animal. It has a burning eyes. So what immortal hands? What hands might have created that tiger? Because we know that it is that tiger is an animal with such a beautiful symmetry. Isn't it? In what distant deep skies or burn the fire of thine eyes? On what wings dare he aspire? What hand or what hand dare seize the fire? So he's asking, where this being could have been created? What tiger could have been created? Is it in the deep sky or in the water? So, in first stanza, he's asking who has created, who created tiger? Because tiger is such a ferocious animal. So, one who created tiger, he is equally or more than more ferocious than that of tiger. So, the poet is wondered at the ability of the creator. In second stanza, he's asking about the place where this being could have been created. Is it in the deep sea or in the skies? Burn fire of thine eyes, on what wings dare he aspire, and what hand dare seize the fire? Anyway, since tiger is having such a fire in his eyes, he could have been created only in the upper sky. Because fire is a divine thing which belongs to the heaven. We know that Prometheus, the Greek god who had stolen the fire and gifted to mankind. So since tiger is made of fire, he is created in the sky. So he's asking, what wings dare he aspire? I mean, one who created tiger, he might have had wings, because then only he could reach the fire that is in the upper sky. So what hands dare seize the fire? Because only such a person can he says that in second stanza, he says that tiger is made of fire. So that fire might have been taken from the upper sky. So he's asking, what hand have dared, or which hand hands have dared to do so? Okay, now in the third stanza, What shoulder and what art could twist news of thy heart, and why thy heart began to beat? What red hand and what red feet? Again, he's asking, see, after creating tiger, the particular person has fixed tiger's heart, and it began to beat. So, finally, the tiger has been given the life. Okay. So, he's asking, this person has, I mean, tiger has been given the life, and its heart started to beat. So, what dreaded hand, what dreaded feet, the creator might have possessed. The creator of the tiger had even greater or a powerful heart to create such a ferocious animal. I mean, tiger is very brave. It has such a beautiful symmetry, very powerful eyes. So the one who created tiger is even powerful than tiger. Now, what hammer, what chain, in what furnace was thy brain? Was what the anvil or what dreaded grass dare its deadly terrors clasp? So in the fourth stanza, is asking in which furnace is brain might have molded. The brain of tiger. Okay, is asking what hammer or what tool God have used to create the brain of tiger. Okay. When the stars threw down the spears, watered the heaven. So in third stanza, God has given heart to the tiger. In fourth stanza, he has given the brain to the tiger. He has fixed brain to the tiger. So the poet is asking, in which furnace he has formed the brain of the tiger. Usually we know that what has been created in furnace and all. So he says that the brain of the tiger is created in a furnace. And what speaker doesn't know what all weapons or what all tools the creator has used to fix the brain of tiger. When stars threw down the spears and watered heaven with their tears, did he smite his work to see? Did he who made the lamb make thee? So when stars are the heavenly things, isn't it? They are the archangels or the attendants or the servants of the God. So when they are the, we can say they are the superior among God's creation, stars. So when they have seen the tiger, once the tiger is created, when they see such a ferocious creation, even they threw down their spears and tears welled up in their eyes. Tears welled up in the eyes of those archangels. Did he smile his work to see? Did he who made the lamp make thee? So God him. So he is asking whether God is whether God is wondered at his own creation, and he's asking, is this the same creator who made the lamb, who had created the tiger? Okay, so actually the poet is wondering how could the one who created lamb, because lamb is such a meek, humble isn't a creature, how such a creature, a creator who had created lamb could create tiger. Tiger burning bright in forest of night, what immortal hand or eye dare frame thy fearful symmetry? So even though this is a replication or same as the first stanza, he made a change in the last line. Instead of asking who had created tiger, he in the last line asks that who dared to create such a fearful symmetry. It could be God, because only he is more ferocious than tiger. So here poet presents the two aspects of God. I mean the innocent or the meek as meek side, as well as the what, the ferocious side. I told you this poem is a companion poem to Lamb that we will study later. Okay, one second. Now, yeah, that we have I have explained this poem. Anyway, this poem was published in 1794 as one of the Songs of Experience. Tiger is a poem about the nature of creation, much as his earlier poem, Songs of Innocence. I mean, the Lamb belongs to Songs of Innocence because I told you, adult beings are hypocrite. They are shrewd. They are very, human beings are very cunning. I mean, adult are very cunning, but a child is very innocent. So, Songs of Innocence, he sees the world through the eyes of a child. So, Lamb belongs to the Songs of Innocence and Tiger belongs to the Songs of Experience. Okay. As I said, it shows the two contrary states of human soul. Anyway, like every being, isn't it? We have to pass through different state of being. Being very serious, being very innocent, or being very experienced, and finally reaching the stage of a sage. So once going through all these stages, only one attains that higher type of knowledge, or the higher level of consciousness. Okay. So that's all about the poem, Tiger. Now, Lamb. One second. So as I said, Lamb and Tiger are companion poems. One second, let me take the poem. Hold for a second. Hello. Yeah. One second. You know, oh, my daughter. Okay. So little lamb who made thee, that thou know who made thee, gave thee life and bid thee feed by the stream over the mead, gave thee clothing of delight, softest clothing woolly bright, gave thee such a tender voice, making all whales rejoice. Little lamb who made thee, that thou know who made thee. Little lamb, I will tell thee. Little lamb, I will tell thee. He is called by thy name. He is called him. He calls himself a lamb. He is meek. He is mild. He became a little child. I a child, thou a lamb. We are called by his name. Little lamb, God bless thee. Little lamb, God bless thee. So lamb, I told you, he has first written Lamb, then only he has written Tiger. And Lamb belongs to Songs of Innocence and Tiger belongs to Songs of Experience. So let me tell you something. In this poem, in the first stanza, is a set of questions asked by the child. Because I told you, in Songs of Experience, he sees the world through the eyes of a child. So everything is very, child is very curious about whatever thing he sees, isn't it? So when he see when he saw a lamb, he became very excited and he is asking many rhetorical questions. In the first stanza, in the second stanza, he is answering to his own question. The child is answering his own question, just like in the tiger. Here also the speaker asks, "Who has created the lamb?" In tiger, poet is asking, the elderly speaker, the grown up speaker is asking, who has created such a ferocious being? That is tiger. None other than God, because only God is more ferocious or more fearful than that of tiger. Oh, isn't it? Similarly, who has created lamb? It could be God. Okay, little lamb, who made thee? That know who made thee? So a child is asking, to the lamb, do you know who has created created you, has given you life, who is feeding you, who has given you such a sweet voice, so who has given you such a beautiful clothing, such a beautiful wool. So child is asking a number of questions like this in the first stanza. In the second stanza, little lamb, I will tell thee. Okay, child is answering his own question. Okay, I will tell thee, he is called by thy name. Okay, the one who has created you is called by thy name. Why? Because we know that Jesus Christ is calls himself shepherd, isn't it? He's a shepherd of the entire world, one who guides the entire living thing. So I know the one who created you is known by thy name. He calls himself a lamb, isn't it? Jesus Christ calls himself and his creations lamb. He is meek and he is mild. Our creator is meek and meek and mild. He became a little child. I a child, thou a lamb. Okay, so let me tell you, what are the qualities of a lamb? Lamb is very innocent, soft, meek and mild. Similarly, what are the qualities of a child? Child is also very innocent, soft, mild, like lamb. So here, child equates Jesus Christ with that of the lamb, isn't it? Child equates Jesus Christ with that of the lamb because, one who created lamb as meek, mild, soft, and innocent, he is also like that. And child who shares this quality of lamb, because both the child and the lamb are innocent and they are pure, isn't it? They are innocent, pure. So I a child and thou a lamb. Jesus Christ was also a child once, isn't it? We are called by his name. So both the child and the lamb are called by his name, the great shepherd. The little lamb, God bless thee. Little lamb, God bless thee. So in this poem, child, lamb, and God are one. So I already told you the philosophy of William Blake. That is what he has executed in all his poems, that human beings, God, or God and his creations, he doesn't view that has two different entities but has a single thing. Okay, that is what has been told in this poem, that lamb, child, and God are one, because it is the God who had created lamb and the child. So both these creations share the similar quality with that of the God. Okay, now, yeah. So as I told you, Lamb was taken from Songs of Innocence, published in 1789. Okay. Now the next poem is Chimney Sweeper. So let me tell you, 19th century English society, England was highly industrialized. Okay, so many changes has been brought in England, that is economically, politically, socially. England had changed a lot. So during those time, small children, they were badly exploited because they have been used as chimney sweepers. Okay, they have been used as chimney sweepers. This young orphan boys. These orphan boys were used as chimney sweepers. They were sent to the long chimney. Dark long chimney, and they. It is these. Boys who swept the. Chimney. Okay. So many children have died due to suffocation or due to the inhalation of the poisonous gases inside the chimney. Anyway, our William Blake and other poets of 19th century and other social activists, they were against this tradition and they have revolted against it. As a protest, he has written many poems about chimney sweepers. Okay, so the he was not only against this tradition, but also prostitutes, thieves, then soldiers. I mean, those soldiers who held the lower ranks of society in 18th century England. He sees those people, I said, prostitutes, thieves, chimney sweepers, soldiers, etc., are what? A creation of, are created by the 18th century, I mean, not 18th century, 19th century society. Okay. They are the one who carry the old dirt and burden of the England. Okay. So, one second. So, in this poem, he protests against the inhuman practice of chimney sweeping. They use children as chimney sweepers. So, the speaker of this poem is a child himself. One second, can you hear me? Are you able to see the slide? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, okay. So, yeah. I told you the speaker of this poem is a child. He himself is a chimney sweeper. When my mother died, I was very young. I mean, this boy was very young when his mother died. My father sold me while yet my tongue could scarcely cry. Weep, weep, weep. Anyway, that term, weep, weep, is a sarcasm. It's a pun because child was very small. He couldn't even pronounce the word sweep, sweep, sweep. He doesn't know what is the meaning of sweep. At that age only, his father sold him to a master sweeper. During 19th century, early 18th, early 19th century, orphans, all the newborn babies, newborn babies who don't have guardians, they were sold to the master sweepers or poor orphanages in England. From there, they were bought by master sweepers or from other traders, and they were sent as chimney sweepers. Yes. So before the child could pronounce the word sweep, 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 he was sent to clean the chimney. So your chimney I sweep and in soot I sleep. So he says that it is inside the chimney that these children usually sleep. There is little Tom Darce who cried when his head that curled like a lamb back. I was shaved, so I said, "Hush, Tom, never mind it, for your head bare. Head's bare. You know that soot cannot spoil your white hair." So he's telling, there was a little boy. His name is Tom Darce. He was crying. Why he cried? Because his hair was shaved. Just like a lamb. Lamb is shaved. He cannot do anything against, lamb cannot do anything against it. Why? Because people are shaving lamb for its wool. Similarly, here the boy's head is shaved. And when he cried, the master sweeper said, told him that you should not cry, because once you go inside the chimney, your hair won't catch fire and your hair won't get spoiled. Your hair, nothing will happen. It will make you can pass through the chimney smoothly. Okay, that is why he shaved the head of the boy. Okay, so he was quiet, and that very night, as Tom was sleeping, he had such a sight that thousands of sweepers, Dick, Joy, Ned, Jack, we were all of them locked up in coffins of black. So let me tell you, so many children were used like this. Many children, thousands of children have lost their life in chimneys due to the inhalation of poisonous gases. In this boy had a dream that night. In that dream, he saw many other sweepers like him. There are many other sweepers, Dick, Joy, Ned, etc. He names them. All those children are lying in the coffin. Because I told you many children have died. So these children are now lying dead in the coffin. Okay. I haven't included the next set of lines, but let me tell you. And in the next stanza, you can see that the children who are lying in the coffin, they were resurrected by the angel. See, angel came and she opened the coffin and she set. She sets all those boys in the coffin free, isn't it? Actually, these children, as they are born they are born and they are they have no one to take care of them, so they were forced to do such kind of odd jobs. But when they died, they were attended by the angel, and they were set free after their death. Okay. Now, so when now they are led to a river, where they are washing themselves. See, the bodies of these chimney sweepers are covered with soot. So angel is preparing them to them for heaven. Okay. So they were asked to wash their body. They washed their body. Now they are shining just like sun. Now they are naked, but they are white. Okay. Now, in the sixth stanza, then naked and white, all their backs left behind. They rise upon the clouds and sport in the wind. Angel told Tom if he had be a good boy, he would have God for his father and never want joy. Okay. So, these boys now left their back and left all their worries and suffering on earth, and they have started their divine journey to the heaven. Okay. So, angel is telling Tom, Tom Dars. Okay. The speaker of this poem is Tom Dars. He's telling his own story in disclosing his own story, he sees a divine vision. In this divine vision, he sees many other chimney sweepers like him, like Dick, Joe, Ned, Jack. All of them are lying dead in the coffin, and they were resurrected by angel. And angel had told them to take a wash in the river, so has to clean them from the soot. Okay, after washing themselves, they are set free. Now they have left behind all their sorrow, suffering on earth. Now they are sporting with the wind. They have been raised to the clouds. So angel is advising Tom, if you are a good boy, if you had been a good boy, if you are leaving if you are leading a good life, you too will have God has your father. Okay. Don't worry that you don't have a father or mother. When you reach the heaven, you will get God as your father and protector. Okay. So in the last stanza, also Tom awoke. We rose in the dark and got with our backs our brushes to work. So when he woke up, he understood that it was only a dream. Actually, all those promise given by angel that if he is a good boy, then he will be taken to the heaven where he will get God as his father. So that is only a promise he got from angel in his dream. Okay. Anyway, from the next day onwards, he takes his bag and brushes and happily goes to work, and he started doing his work happily, because he believes that someday he will be set free just like the boys he had seen in the dream were set free. Okay, that, like that, he will be set free someday and he'll be taken to heaven where he can live happily with his father, that is God. That is a summary of Chimney Sweeper, very touching. So, this poem is actually what? A social protest against the exploitation of the little boys. Now, next poem is Divine Image. Very simple poem. To mercy, pity, peace, and love, all pray in their distress, and to these virtues of delight return their thankfulness. For mercy, pity, yeah. So mercy, pity, peace, and love, these are the four qualities of God, isn't it? So we human beings pray in our distress, isn't it? When we are happy, we don't pray, but whenever we feel bad, we pray to God, to mercy, pity, peace, and love, or to these virtues of delight return their thankfulness. When we get something good, we will thank God. For mercy, pity, peace, love is God our Father dear. So he's asking, actually, these four qualities are the qualities of God himself. So speaker is asking, for mercy, pity, peace, love is God, our Father dear, God himself. And mercy, pity, peace, love is man. Since God has created man, God possesses all these qualities. Since God has created man, human beings to possess this quality, because human being is his child. For mercy has a heart, pity has a human face, love the human form divine, and peace the human distress. So the man says that if these things were given a human form, mercy, pity, peace, love, if these things were given a human form, then mercy forms the human heart, pity forms the human face, love forms the human divine form, and peace the human dress. Every man of every clime prays in his distress, prays to human form divine, love, mercy, pity, and peace. So who is the God? See, when in this age, in the age of distress, isn't it, in this age of calamity or in this age of pandemic, is it possible to see the real God? Who's the real God? God is someone who can understand the very condition of his fellow being, or with the very heart of his fellow being. So he equates man with that of God. I mean, anyone or the human beings who possess the quality love, mercy, I mean qualities such as love, mercy, pity, and peace, he is equal to that of God, because these are the qualities of God. We pray to God when we are in distress, when we are helpless, for love, pity, mercy, and peace, isn't it? So since God possesses these qualities, God is the creator of man, and God possesses these qualities. Since God possesses these qualities, it is natural that his creations will also have the same qualities. Okay, so here he tries to give shape to these qualities. He's giving shape to this quality, that is mercy is human heart, pity is human face, love is human physique, and peace is his dress. So then all these qualities get a human shape. So we pray, we beg in front of our fellow beings, isn't it? Now we seek help from our fellow beings. So God is none but human being himself. I mean, one who can understand the feeling or the situation of his fellow's being is equal to that of God. All must love the human form in her Turk or Jew. Where mercy, love, pity dwell, the God is dwelling too. So as a human being, we should be able to love our fellow beings. So God is present in all. Let it be Turk. Turk people, Turkish people are considered to be uncivilized. Let it be Jew. They are very shrewd, isn't it? Jewish people are considered to be very shrewd. So let it be an uncivilized being like Turk or a cunning man belong to Jewish race. God is in all. Okay, where mercy, love, pity dwell. So poet says that where mercy, love, pity, and peace are dwelling, God is also dwelling in them. A man who is the embodiment of all these qualities is none but God himself. Okay, it's a very simple poem. Okay, we have seen. Now, the theme. I told you he was again the blind idolatry system or those worships in temples, church. See, he believed in the goodness of human beings. Okay. Now, as I told you, there is a didactic nature, the didactic element in all his poetry. He's giving a message. If you read the poems of William Blake, you can understand his poems always carry some higher messages in the poem, isn't it? Higher messages. Once again, then in this poem, he spreads the very idea of universal fraternity. He takes the he has taken the entire humankind has what and a humankind kind together. He refers that we all are children of God, so we are brothers and sisters, so we have to be good with one another. Now, next poem is Sick Rose. This is a very symbolic poem. This poem can be read in many level. So, O Rose, thou art sick, the invisible worm that flies in the night in the howling storm has found out thy bed of crimson joy and his dark secret love does thy life destroy. The main characters of this poem are Rose and a Worm. We know that Rose and a Worm. Rose is the embodiment of beauty, love, and innocence. Whereas Worm represent evil, selfishness, and other dark qualities. So if you're reading in another level, Rose is female and Worm is male. Okay, the male pursuit, the very entering of Worm to Rose, very entering of Worm to Rose can be seen as the male pursuit of female love, or the very pursuit of male for physical pleasure. That is why I told you this poem can be read in many levels. Rose, thou art sick. Thus, the invisible worm that flies in the night in the howling storm. So, Rose, it's appearing very. It is very sick now. Why? Some invisible worm had entered it in the night during the howling storm during a stormy night. Some worm has entered the rose. Okay, now the rose is sick. And the roses appear to be sick. So in the first stanza, we can see that we can see that the virginity of a woman. A particular woman has lost her virginity during one night because her secret lover had cheated her. Has found out thy bed of crimson joy and his dark secret love that thy life destroyed. Anyway, the secret lover has enjoyed your crimson, has found out thy bed of crimson joy and his dark secret love that thy life destroyed. due to the selfishness of the lover, he destroyed the very lovely bed of the rose, that is the women. He destroyed the very purity of the women. That is why now the women or the sick, the rose is appearing to be very sick. Very simple poem. Loss of innocence. So this poem is about the loss of innocence. That is, woman has lost her innocence, or the rose has lost its beauty. I told you, rose is female or woman, and worm is the male. Okay. It also talks about the temptation that women will have once she attains puberty. Okay. Okay, once again. Now the next poem is London. I wandered through each chartered street, near where the chartered Thames does flow, and mark in every face I meet, marks of weakness, marks of woe. So in this poem, London, again, once again, just like chimney sweeper, he's against the restrictions of the 19th century society, because according to William Blake, 19th century society is the most restrictive society in England's history, the one that he lives in. Okay, so I want 19th century London has offered many restrictions upon people. Okay, the upper class people, they are very happy, but the condition of the women, children, I mean underprivileged, were very pathetic. So he is agitating against such traditions. I wander through the each chartered street, near where the chartered Thames flow now. Mark in every face I meet, marks of weakness, marks of woe. So wherever he moves through London, he can see restrictions upon everything, upon everyone. Whatever, see, wherever he looked or whomever he looked at, he can see the trace of weakness or marks of suffering. Okay, in every cry of every man, in every infant's cry of fear, in every voice, in every ban, the Ming Foch Manaclus I hear. So, even in the cry of man, infants, he can hear the sound of ban, restriction, shackles or manacles, restrictions, ordinary men, underprivileged, okay, infants, everyone is in fetters, everyone are chained. People in the lowest strata are chained. Everyone is chained in the lowest strata. How the chimney sweeper cry, every blackening church appals and hapless soldier's sigh, runs in the blood down palace walls. Now he discusses about the chimney sweepers, the very sound, the very, very, very agony or the very sufferings of the chimney sweeper. He can hear it. Every blackening church appal. See, these chimney sweepers, they go up high and they clean the chimney. And they are suffocating inside that chimney. They're crying sound, actually, that are falling as a curse upon the church. People who wear white dress in the church, and who carry out the rituals, even though they are wearing white garments, actually they are blackened due to the cry of the children that spend in the chimney. And hapless of the soldiers sigh. Soldiers, they are simply fighting with each other in the battlefield. They are, why? Is it because of their own fault? No. Are they fighting for themselves? No. They are fighting for the corrupt government. They don't have any kind of enmity against the fellow being or somebody from the enemy troop. They are seeing those people for the first time, and they don't have any kind of grudge against them. It is for the corrupt government. They are fighting and they are losing their life. Okay. Anyway, their blood runs down the palace and it stains the palace, just like the cry of chimney sweepers blackens the church walls. But the most through the midnight street I hear how youthful harlots curse, blast the newborn infant's tear, and blight with the plagues the marriage hearse. And when he walks through the street during midnight, some lady is named harlot. Okay, it can be any lady, any unmarried woman of the 19th century, a prostitute who was forced into prostitution for a life. Okay, she is cursing her fatherless baby instead of consoling the baby. She is cursing her baby. Okay, so it shows the very loss of innocence. Okay, because harlot is not a single person, not a single lady, but it represents the entire people of the 19th century whose hearts have been hardened after witnessing French Revolution and many other civil wars and many bloodshed wars. Their hearts have been hardened. Their hearts had been hardened. Now they are not in a mind or a position to attend a baby or the very cry of a baby. They don't know how to soothe a baby. Instead, when they hear the very sound of a baby crying, here the mother herself is cursing the baby. So that shows the hardened mentality of the 19th century people. Okay, blights with plagues the marriage hearse. Now again he says that the so-called institution marriage, because we can I told you here onwards 17th and 16th century was people don't have during that time people didn't have any kind of morals. They were loosely moral because Charles II, when he was restored, he brought that French mannerism in the palace, and people followed his manners. When Oliver Cromwell came into throne, he being a Protestant ruler, people became very they constrained themselves just like Oliver Cromwell, and they followed the Protestant traditions. They he shut down all type of theaters, and he didn't encourage poets, artists as Charles II or Charles I encouraged during their time. So he says that people have become very serious, and there are a lot of restrictions upon them. So actually marriage is a plague to a true love. One second. So the next poem, actually we are starting block 7 now. P.B. Shelley, one of the major romantic poets belonging to the second generation. He died at the age of 35. He was accidentally drowned to death. Unlike Coleridge and Wordsworth, he is a revolutionary poet. In fact, all poets of second generation are revolutionary in nature. Okay, now this person, was a what an atheist, a supporter of free love. His wife's name is Mary Shelley, who authored Frankenstein. Now, his biographer is Leigh Hunt. And he belonged to the poet, a special circle of poet, included Lord Byron, John Keats, Leigh Hunt, Thomas Lowe, Peacock. Okay. His famous poems are Ode to West Wind, Skylark, Ozymandias, Mask of Anarchy, Necessity of Atheism. And he is a radical in his political and his social views. Okay. He has expelled from his from the university for being a blasphemer. None of the publishers were ready to publish his work for being arrested for the sedition. And he lost one of his sons. During that time only he has written Ode to West Wind. So his life was very problematic. All his problems, we can see whatever things, his poems are very, has always carried some revolutionary ideas, unlike Coleridge and Wordsworth. All the sufferings and problems in his personal life has have reflected in his poems as well. Well, now, yeah. His theories, his revolutionary ideas have influenced many of the Russian and French writers like Leo Tolstoy and Karl Marx. Even though Shelley wasn't that popular during his lifetime, and even though he was discarded and he was not accepted by his own society, later he became a model to the poet of 19th century, 20th century, and late 21st century. He became a dear poet to them. Now, Shelley, he's a lyricist, a lover of nature, he believed in the power construction, power structure, and his idealism, symbolism, love, etc. Influenced, the poets of the future, next generation. Now, the poems that you have in block 7 is Triumph of Life. Okay, Triumph of Life is a unfinished poem, just like Prelude. Yeah. So, Triumph of Life, an unfinished poem by P.B. Shelley. Poem was first published in the collection of posthumous poem in London. Let me tell you, while he was working upon this poem only, he was accidentally drowned to death. Now, this poem was influenced by Dante's Inferno and Petrarch's Triumphi. Okay. Now, the very title of the poem is taken from Petrarch's Triumphi. Then there are 548 lines in this poem. Okay, it's an unfinished poem. Let me tell you, this is very a poem. I will not say that it's very difficult, but this can be read in many levels. And he, just like William Blake, Shelley is also attacking all sort of institutions in life. Human beings, actually, we human beings have been institutionalized in the terms of religion, philosophy, ideology, politics, etc. So Shelley, he was against this. So in the Triumph of Life, he says that human beings, many great people have been swept by or demolished by life because they were blinded by their own philosophies or religion or something like that. Okay. Triumph of Life, an overview. The poem covers so much interpretative ground that it is difficult to be tied together all of its strains of meaning into a unified whole. So you cannot interpret the world in terms of a single thing. Now let me tell you, in this poem he's interpreting different types of books like Bible or mathematical concepts, science, etc. Okay, so he says that universe is essentially chaotic. Our universe or the planet we live on is essentially chaotic, and it is not possible to bring them under some control or restriction. It is meant to be set free. Yeah. So as I told, he attacks the different types of institutions. Now, here he says that life is the biggest teacher. Life is the greatest teacher, and life is very strict. He presents life as a strict or a tyrant figure, and punishing the, executing people for following those kind of institution. Life is a teacher, is a tyrant figure, and it executes people who have been institutionalized. So in this poem, he's having some kind of vision. Poet is having a vision, just like William Blake's poem. He's having a vision. See, Plato, Aristotle, Alexander, or Napoleon Bonaparte, Hitler, so many people like that, or religious leaders, rulers, politicians, they are led by some ideologies, isn't it? They are led by some ideologies, but towards the end, all will succumb in front of life. They will have to die someday. So initially, they will gain some kind of power or what, earthly, victories like that. But finally, what happens to them? It is life that triumphs, isn't it? It is the life that triumphs. So all sort of human victories are transient in nature. Human victories or human beliefs, ideologies, etc., temporary in nature. Only the preaching of life or what life has given us, the higher knowledge or what life has taught us, is permanent. Now, the theme of life, triumph of life. So he says that life is a painted veil. Anyway, life is more powerful than love, death, fame, chastity, divinity, or time. We human beings waste our time for love, fame, chastity, divinity. For different purpose, we waste our time. But ultimately, who conquers the life? It is who conquers this life itself, isn't it? Actually, it is our ideology that corrupts us. Now, so our life is associated with sleep, death, memory, and we try to escape from these what actually our life is very monotonous. We don't have any higher kind of things to do. But we try to escape from these type of circle by doing, by believing in some kind of ideologies. And according to Shelley, that is a violation of cosmic principle, because I told you, universe or the world is essentially chaotic. So there, no one can bring world under some power, or no one can force anyone to believe in some kind of ideology or belief. Shelley, an atheist deeply concerned with social health of 19th century, under the control of religious institution and monarchical rules. And see, he is against the monarchical rules, beliefs. So in this poem, actually, he is satirizing those religious readers, rulers, etc. Now, anyway, I told you he was influenced by Dante's Divine Comedy and Petrarch's Triumph, Triumphi. Okay. So the Petrarch has used it is Dante who has used terza rima in Divine Comedy. It is a chain rhyme A B A B C B C D C and D E E. Now, so in Petrarch's Triumphi, there are six types of rhymes: love, chastity, death, fame, time, and eternity. See, in Petrarch's Triumphi, he has used these rhymes in somewhat a positive type. Yes, I used in a positive way, but in Shelley's Triumph of Life, he rather used it in a negative way. Now, the speaker of this poem, Shelley, some part Shelley appears as the speaker, but but at some point, Rousseau, the leader of French Revolution, he presents Rousseau as the speaker. Okay. Now, Triumph of Life. Swift as the spirit hasting to his task of glory of good, sun sprang forth, rejoicing in splendor, and the mask of the darkness fell from the earth, vacant earth. So, in the first four lines, he says that sun has risen in the sky and it had awakened the earth. Earth has had been fully brightened. So, mask from so many people's faces have been fallen down. Actually, many people, those people who are following, who have been institutionalized, are wearing a mask. Once the sun has risen, it had awakened the earth and it had given enlightenment to some people. As a result, masks from their face have fallen. Flame them or the crimson cloud at the birth of light, an ocean or horizon arose, to which the birds tempered their matinly, all flowers in field or forest which unclose the trembling eyelids to the kiss of day, swinging the censers in the element with orient incense lit by the new ray. Let me tell you, this Shelley is a poet. It's an optimistic poet. If you're familiar with the Ode to West Wind, the last line, if winter comes, can spring be far behind? See, he always hoped for a better dawn, or a better future. So he says that someday, the time will come that masks or false ideology will be eradicated from the planet, where people will believe themselves. Instead of believing some fake philosophies or ideology, they will start to believe their own intuitions, just like William Blake. Okay. So, part one, or line number 1 to 40, he says what I have already mentioned: sun rises and nature is awakened, and the speaker introduce himself. At first, it is the poet himself. This person is way down due to his personal sorrows. He lost his son. As the sun arises, the poet falls into a dream vision. Now, from line number 41 to 175, he describes the vision he had. He says that he find himself standing in the a public way, and he can see so many people moving like a stream. All people in that stream are very much obsessed. They are not satisfied. You cannot see any glow or a happiness on their face. Instead, all these people are very deficient, limited, and obsessed. And he also sees a chariot, a chariot which was driven by a deformed sheep. He doesn't know who is riding that chariot, who's driving the chariot. Anyway, the chariot has four faces, just like Janus. Janus is a Greek figure. Who can see past and future, who can see past and future. So the one who drives the chariot is a Janet like figure, and he is blindfolded. Okay, anyway, that pageant is attended by millions of people. Okay, the chariot is attended by millions of people. It is that divine shape, that form, deformed shape, who's leading that procession. So many people have been chained to that chariot. So chariot is dragging the greatest people like Plato, Alexander, Aristotle, Napoleon. So many people have been chained to that chariot. I told you, who could be person in the chariot? Actually, poet has personified life. One who is driving the chariot is none but life itself. Life itself. Okay. And it has chained so many great people like Plato, Aristotle, and Napoleon. Why? We know that these people have institutionalized something, isn't it? Alexander and Napoleon and power hungry. Plato and Aristotle have their own philosophies. Similarly, whoever tried to institutionalize life, they have fallen there for their own course. Only the sacred few like Jesus, Socrates, who early fled back like eagles to their native moon. See, some wise people like Socrates and Jesus Christ and John the Baptist have been escaped from this mad race. Okay. And some people are wildly dancing in front of the chariot, they fall in front of the chariot, and chariot passes through them. Okay, so and those men and women who dance in front of the chariot, and who are swept over by the chariot, are actually corrupted. Okay, are actually corrupted. And anyway, the light light coming from the chariot blinds the people who have been crowded there. Okay. Now, dismayed by the sight of frantic, line number 176 to 295. Here he presents Rousseau. Okay. Poet has many questions. Anyway, his questions are answered by Rousseau, the leader of French Revolution. He was presented as a deformed figure. Instead of eyes, he has holes. So let me tell you, Rousseau in this Triumph of Life actually guides Shelley. I told you almost all romantic poets are influenced by Rousseau or French Revolution. So just like Virgil had guided Dante in Inferno, through Inferno in Divine Comedy, just like that, Rousseau is guiding our Shelley in Triumph of Life. Okay, so poet has n number of questions. Why people, so many great people have been punished. Why they have been punished by life. So Rousseau is answering for that. Okay. So anyway, Rousseau's French Revolution was a failure, isn't it? So Rousseau now understood why it had become a failure. So he speaks about those great people who have been chained. So he explained I mean those prisoners, prisoners in I mean those people who have been chained, are bishops, warriors, king, philosophers, Voltaire, Napoleon, Frederick, Great Emmanuel. See, you see the name of these people. See, these people belong to some kind of institution, power, religion, church, like that. Okay, so all those people who are involved in some kind of structures or institution, of course they will be perished. So yeah, so Rousseau now answers why Plato was punished. Plato was a homosexual, isn't it? Plato was a homosexual. He had been fallen for his love for a young man, that is for his own student. Aristotle fell because of his association with Alexander. Similarly, many other eminent people, Immanuel Kant, because of his religious belief. So basically, people are corrupted because of their own ideologies or beliefs. Now, lines from 296 to 438. Let me tell you, so far Rousseau was a spectator, but from part 4 you can see that from a spectator he turns to an actor. Now speaker, that is Rousseau, is telling his own story, that where he had come from. Okay, so he says that he had come from a forest, a dark, thick forest. He was sleeping when he woke up. He was sleeping in a cave under a mountain, and there was a river flowing nearby, similar to the river in Lethe in myth, which induces forgetfulness in human being. So when he woke up, he forgot his past, and he sees a shape in front of them, a shape in front of him. He equates the face, the shape to that of a woman. So has he lost his memory? When he asked to the light about his identity, he was given a crystal glass full of drug, that is nepenthine. So when he drank it, he had a divine vision. All his false concept about life or related with different things had been removed. Now he had gained the true wisdom about life. So according to poet Shelley, life is not like what we perceived through books or from other people or our ideologies. It is something that we directly perceive through the experience we have. Okay. Now, Rousseau, I told you Rousseau asked so many questions. To the shape, and he obtained knowledge from that cup. So after that, returning to part 5, we can see that now Rousseau can see everything clearly. Now he understood why the people, why the eminent personalities have been crucified, why they have been punished. Previously, Rousseau was equally ignorant as our poet Shelley. He doesn't know why the chariot is coming, why the chariot is carrying all people, why the great men are, souls of the great men have been chained, why some people have been crushed by life. Now he, after drinking from that cup of wisdom, he understood that the greatest teacher is life. It's life itself. Okay. So now he can see phantom-like figures. Previously, he has seen so many. He has seen so many eccentric characters dancing in front of the chariot. Now he can see phantom-like figures because all those people who believe in, philosophies and religion, they are actually not living, but they are dead. They are phantom-like figures. Previously, Rousseau had been blinded by his own light of philosophy, isn't it? He had some kind of vision. He had his own philosophy. He was equally corrupted as other people. But now he had drank from the cup of knowledge. Now he can see the truth. Now he can see the laws of nature. That means one has to obey the laws of nature. It is not possible to conquer the world. Okay, it's not possible to conquer the world. Now, yeah. And the fragment ends with the poet question, then what is life? The speaker of this poem is actually very confused with the very concept of life. Then what is life? If life is not about following some kind of ideology or philosophies or any method or institution, then what is life? Okay, one second. So anyway, I told you he's a revolutionary poet. He's an optimistic poet. So even though when we read this poem, we feel that this is an absurd poem because just like an absurdist, Shelley says that life doesn't have a greater meaning or any greater philosophy, and we cannot attach or relate any greater philosophy to it. Still, we can see that that usual Shelley type optimism and vigor in certain lines, and he says that everything in the world is temporary. Okay. If you are ready to discard all those fake philosophies and our belief, then we will be free from the disappointments. Now, the theory that you can relate to this is hermeneutics. So hermeneutics is such a branch of study where one is interpreting books, literary text. You can read literary text. I mean, reading literary text in terms of Bible or other scientific books. Okay. Basically, Shelley is trying to bring utopian philosophy or utopian world. Less like Thomas More, he is looking for an utopian society. He's longing for a better society. He just wants to discard the old philosophies that is misleading people or the world. So he is trying to interpret. Instead of interpreting literary books in terms of Bible and other philosophical books, he is interpreting Bible or other philosophy books in terms of life. Okay, I told you the theory of hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is basically interpreting Bible and other literary and other texts in terms of it's exactly opposite. I'm sorry. I mean, interpreting literary text in terms of Bible and other philosophies. But in this text, in this poem, he is interpreting Bible and other philosophies in terms of life. Okay. Now the next poem is Hyperion, John Keats. It's a very simple poem. It's more or less like a story. And this is also an unfinished poem, just like Triumph of Life and Prelude. Shelley, I'm this person died at a very young age, that is at the age of 26. One of the major figures of second generation of Romantic poets. And this person was an apothecary, and he lost his other siblings due to consumption. Then Leigh Hunt was his close friend and biographer. Now, he is a bit Hellenistic in nature. He was influenced by the Greek culture and myth. You can see in his poems, let it be odes, sonnets, or whatever. He has used the Greek mythology in it. Similarly, in Hyperion also, you can see Greek myth. Now, so after completing a small portion, he stopped writing Hyperion because I told you he lost his brother due to conception. After 1 year, he too died because of conception. Okay. Now, Hyperion. It was first published in 1818 and unfinished version in 18. Three books are there, book one, book two, and book three. Okay. It basically talks about the change in governance, just like not only on Earth, but change in governance is also among God. Okay. It is based on Titomachia. So the early rulers of the universe were Titans. They were displaced by Olympians, just like the same governance change in our time. Okay. Now, so let me tell you, here Hyperion is the sun god. Hyperion belongs to Titan. I mean, early rulers of the universe, and Apollo. Apollo is a new god who belongs to Olympians. Just like that, the rise of Apollo, fall of Hyperion. The poem discusses about the fall of Hyperion and the rise of Apollo. Similarly, talks about the rise of Keats as a true poet. Previously, he was just a shadow. But at the age, at a particular point of life, he attained, he understood his true purpose in life, and thereafter he becomes a true poet. And he says that one can only become a true poet only if he is able to identify the good quality in his fellow beings. Similarly, he relates himself with that of Apollo. Here, Keats is comparing himself with that of Apollo. Now, so I told you in this poem, when he starts the poem, he says Titans were displaced by Olympians, not because Titans are very bad or Olympians are too good, but it is the law of nature that when a bigger spirit comes, a lower spirit has to make room for it. Previously, see, at the beginning of the universe, it was chaotic and dark. It is the chaos. It is chaos and darkness that world the that reigned the world at first. Okay, later Titans conquered chaos and darkness, and they became the rulers. And they ruled for a pretty long time. After that, they were defeated by Olympians. Isn't it? The ruler of Titans, king of Titans is Saturn. He's the eldest son of Uranus. He's the eldest son of Uranus. Saturn, according to the Greek mythology, Saturn, the ruler of Titans, is the eldest son of Uranus or Coelus. Okay. And Hyperion is the sun god, early sun god. Now, so just like Apollo Apollo was not a god initially. He was a mortal being. He was a mortal. And he was a dreamer. Just like Keats, he was also a dreamer. But having a divine revelation, after getting a divine revelation, Apollo was elevated to the status of a god. Okay. Similarly, after having that divine revolutionary, Keats also become a true poet. One should be able to understand the feelings of the fellow being or the suffering of the humanity. You should be able to embrace it. You should be able to report it. One should be able to touch the human heart. Then only one will become a true poet. Anyway, Apollo embodies all these quality. So similarly, Keats is also among the romantic poet. Among romantic poets, Keats was a sensitive poet. He was a sensitive poet. Now, so Hyperion is basically about the process, power, and change. So what is the only thing that remains unchanged? That is change itself. So a change is necessary. Not because you are lesser than someone else, because that is the law of nature. We are changing just because of the goodness of the nature. Just for the sake of nature, we are changing. And he also says that this universe is dynamic, not static. Okay. Similarly, governance is also like that. It is not static, it is dynamic. In this poem, he talks about the power structures. See, in this present world, we can see different type of politics or different type of governance or changes in the government. That is not because that one government is good than other, or someone is inferior to someone else. Not because of that. That is the rule that nothing on earth will last long forever. Nothing on earth will last long forever. Every single thing on earth has got some tenor. When it comes to, when the particular thing hits the tenor or it hits the expiry date, it will have to make space for the next thing. That is quite natural. That is what Keith has observed in Hyperion. That is, a change is inevitable or it is mandatory. Now, so theory of negative capability. That is, we human beings, we are guided by some kind of belief, ideology, and we have a tendency to question what we don't believe in, isn't it? So has Coleridge said, willing suspension of disbelief. That is a piece of work is meant to be enjoyed. So it's the ability of a reader to perceive something beyond presupposition. Capacity of a human being to receive a work of art, a work of literature, something, or judging, receiving them without judging it. Okay, that is negative capability, theory of negative capability. That is, it is an expression of supreme empathy. Just believe it for the sake of believing. Okay, without questioning, without being very suspicious about the intention of such a work, just accept it. It is the supreme ability of human being to receive a product without being very prejudiced. Okay, that is said to be negative capability. Anyway. according to Keats, it is Shakespeare who possessed this quality enormously. Now, I told you Greek was, sorry, Keith was influenced by Greek culture, Hellenism. So in his poems, we can see that Greek Keats has used Greek symbols, myth, etc. Now, features of Keats' poetry, his liking for Greek mythology, then sculpture, art, love, beauty, temperance, fatalism, tragedy, legends, using Homer's myth, melancholy, he's a melancholic poet, then romantic elements. These are the features of Hellenistic features in Keats' poetry. Now his love for perfection. See, Apollo is the god of perfection, isn't it? Then his love for all Greek writers, simplicity, then image, you can see concrete imageries in his poem, then pagan worships, pagan delight. Yeah. Now, Hyperion, deep in the shady sadness of a vale, for a sunken from the hearth breath of morn, far from the fiery noon, ever one star, Saturn, sad grace, heard Saturn quite has a stone. So I told you, as the book begins, see, someone is sitting in the valley. He is very sad because he has lost a great battle. Far from the fiery noon, even Eve's one star, Saturn, king of Titans. Gray-haired one. He is sitting quiet. Sit has silence around about his lyre, forest on forest hung about his head like a cloud on cloud. So he's sitting in the middle of a forest beside a valley with his head hung down. So not so much life has one summer day robs not one light seed from the feathered grass, but where the dead leaf fell, there did it rest. A stream was voiceless by still dead and more, as by reason of his fallen divinity, spreading a shade, nape mid her reeds, press her cold finger close to her lips. So why this person is sad? Because he had fallen from the divinity. He had been a god, but he had lost all his power. He had been displaced by Zeus or Jove. Jove or Zeus belong to Olympian. He is an Olympian ruler. I told you, first, who occupied universe? It is chaos and darkness occupied universe. Later, chaos and darkness were conquered by Titans, and their ruler was Saturn. They ruled for a long time. After that, they were displaced by Olympians. And Keats says that, these Olympians will also displace by some other mightier power than them. Okay. So this person is sitting in a valley, sad, as he lost his, he has fallen from the position of God. So I told you there are three books. You have to study three books, Hyperion 1, 2, and 3. So let me tell you, the book one opens in media res. Media res means starting from the middle. So that is a technique used by ancient Greek dramatists so that you can go both back and forth. So the dejected Saturn is attended or visited by Thea. Thea is the wife of Hyperion, and she tries to console Saturn, and she is asking Saturn to visit his fellow subjects. So many Titans have been imprisoned by Olympians, and some are wandering here and there without an abode. So Thea asks Titan to come and visit his fallen Titans. And she is leading Saturn to Titans who are wandering on Earth. And see, even though all Titans had been fallen from their position, there is still one Titan who is in power. That is none but Hyperion, the sun god. So even though the sun god, so other Titans believe that since Hyperion is still in power, they can conquer, because Hyperion is the brightest or the powerful among the Titans. So they believe that with the help of Hyperion, they can still conquer the world. Anyway, book one says that even though Hyperion is still in power, he is reigning. He had some. He started getting some kind of omen that he will be soon displaced. So he is not that happy. So now. He heard a voice from his father Uranus call us that it is the high time that he should visit his eldest brother Saturn and other Titans, and should give strength, and he should help them to regain the power. And it is not worthy for gods to feel dejected. To be pestered by the feelings or to be dejected, etc., are the qualities of human beings. Actually, gods or immortals are not weighed down like this. Anyway, even though Hyperion is still in power, he's constantly threatened. He feels that someone is going to replace him soon. Okay. Now, in book two, Saturn visits Titan. He addresses his fellow Titans, and he says that he doesn't know what to tell them, how to console them, or because even if he says that they should approach Titan, or they should beg in front of Olympian, they will not do so. They will feel okay. One second. Hold for a second. He says that Saturn says that he doesn't know how to console his fellow beings, because they have lost their power both internally and externally. But Encephalus, among them, Encephalus, who still has power or a rage in his eyes, that gives some strength to Saturn. Anyway, rest of the Titans are not that powerful or not that revengeful as Encephalus. Okay. So he asked the opinion of Oceanus. Oceanus is the deep thinker among them. So Oceanus says that, see, this change is inevitable, because Oceanus is replaced by Neptune. Neptune, Oceanus is a Titan, and Neptune is a Olympian. So Oceanus says that my time has come to an end, and I think it is wise to give way, to make space for someone much brighter and impressive than me. And he says that Neptune is much brighter and impressive than me, so I don't feel any kind of grudge that he has replaced me. Anyway, so when he says that, none of the Titans says anything. Now instead, Clemene, she stands up. She's a sea nymph, and she says that morning she happened to hear a sound, a beautiful melodious sound from the valley. She was playing with her musical instrument along the shore. At that time only she heard this song. Anyway, that music was much more powerful and touching than her own song. She is the goddess of music. She felt far inferior to the music she heard along the valley. Anyway, that song was produced by, later we come to know that that song is produced by Lord Apollo. So both Oceanus and Clemens says that time has come, that our rule has come to an end. I mean, those people who have displaced us in different positions, they are far, far superior to us. Oceanus and Clemens try to make the other Titan understand this great truth that this is the law of nature. Okay. Anyway, Enceladus doesn't agree that he has that burning rage in his eyes. He says that our Hyperion is still in power. I'm not ready to take this lukewarm position or ready to accept fate, just like you people believe. Passivity. It is not meant for gods. Okay. At that time only, Hyperion arrives and joins them. And in book 3, you can see that. In Hyperion book 3, we can see that. See, Apollo is still a mortal. He has not become a god yet. But he is having some visions. He is very sensitive. Just like, see, you can see Apollo is none but Keats himself. Here, Keats himself is very sensitive. He's crying. He left his abode. He left his mother and sister, and he is moving. He's walking through the forest. At that time, he felt the presence of some goddess in that forest. And he says that it is not for the first time that he felt the presence of the goddess. But from his birth onwards, he started feeling someone is guarding him. Someone is closely watching him. At that time only, a goddess appeared in front of him. It is none but Mnemosyne. Mnemosyne is a goddess belonging to Titan group. Okay, she is a Titan. Mnemosyne is a Titan. She is the goddess of past, present, and future knowledge. Okay. She is the goddess of seven she is the mother of seven muses, goddess of memory, and mother of nine muses. She is the one who gives that divine knowledge about the past, present, and future to human beings. Or one has the capacity to turn anyone into divine. That is Mnemosyne. Mnemosyne, even though she was she is a Titan, she has been attending Apollo since he was born. Okay. So now our Apollo is not a god. He is only a mortal being. So one day she placed a lyre next to his bed. So when Apollo woke up, he took the lyre and he started to play it. That music only Clemens has heard when she was standing along the shore. So the music that Apollo created with a lyre, that was very divine and far superior to Clemens. So Apollo asked why he was feeling some kind of pain. Every now and then he was pestered and he was feeling he was born for a greater mission. Then Mnemosyne gives him the wisdom of past, present, and future. Okay. Now Apollo started to feel a pain of death all throughout his body. So Apollo is died into life. That means Apollo the mortal is dead and Apollo the god had been born. Okay. So Mnemosyne has turned Apollo into a god. The god. I hope you know that Apollo is the sun god. Now Apollo is. So in the fall of Hyperion, that is an incomplete book. You will study that Apollo replaces Hyperion. We know that Hyperion is the only Titan who is still in power, who hasn't lost the power, but he has got that some kind of sign or some kind of omen that his position is not permanent. Soon he will be displaced by someone mightier than him. that is none but Apollo. Anyway, that is not mentioned in this book because this book is incomplete. Okay, this book breaks over here in book 3. It's very simple, okay? Even if you read this poem one time, you will understand. It's more or less like a story. Just like Paradise Lost, the fall of Adam and Eve. Let's discuss the fall of Titans. Or the fall of Hyperion. And just like Paradise Lost, see, almost all great epics or legendary books, start in the middle. That means media rest, starting in the middle. So starting in the middle gives an advantage. By starting in the middle gives an advantage to the author because he can take his plot back and forth. He can go, he can take the reader. Flashback, and he can also come back to the present. That is a very advantage of using media res or starting from the middle. Milton's Paradise Lost has used this technique. Now Keats has also used media res technique in Hyperion. Okay, so that's all the end of block 7. It's not that difficult, it's very simple. Only thing is you have to understand the ideology that second generation poet, none of them are associated with any kind of philosophy or any kind of ideologies. They all believe in humanity. That means in themselves. Okay. His own or one's own imagination or intuition. Or what is right or what is good for the entire human race. I mean, these poets, Shelley, Keats, and William Blake, etc., are against all types of ideologies, philosophies, and institutions upon earth. According to them, it is the institution, ideology, philosophy that corrupt the human being. If you read from this point, then you will be able to answer the essay question and annotation. Are you still there?
Yes, ma'am.
I have incorporated almost all details in the slide. Please try to read it. Then you may please go through the block 7. You will understand. Okay. Next class, we will discuss block 8. That is the toughest of all block. Block 8 is little tough. Okay then, bye. See you next week.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.